Is that a gram?
New card. What do you think?
Whoa. Very nice. Look at that.
Picked them up from the printers yesterday.
Good coloring.
That's bone. And the lettering is something called Cillian Braille.
It's very cool, Bateman, but that's nothing. Look at this.
That is really nice.
Eggshell with Romalian type. What do you think?
Nice.
Jesus. That is really super. How'd a nitwit like you get so tasteful?
I can't believe that Bryce prefers Van Patten's card to mine.
But wait. You ain't seen nothing yet. Raised lettering. Pale nimbus. White.
Impressive. Very nice. Let's see Paul Allen's card.
Look at that subtle off-white coloring. A tasteful thickness of it. Oh my God. It even has a watermark.
Something wrong? Patrick? You're sweating.
So be honest, would you guys be mad at me if I wore the exact same flannel in this video that I wore in the last one? Just say no. I have noticed a trend somewhat recently in literary fiction towards like publishing more books where sex is like the main thing that's getting discussed. These books often have like pretty high quality, well proportioned, well, mostly.
No.
Covers which range from cheekily symbolic to more openly provocative. And of course, I, degenerate hobbyist, abortion haver, birth control, pill popping, feminist, hellbent on destroying the nuclear family and traditional values and every incel's hellbent on destroying the... I wonder if I need to, like, close these blinds. God, maybe. I'm just gonna do that really quickly. Sorry. You know, I always think, like, more light is better, and then sometimes I get around to... Oh my fucking God. Sometimes I get around to doing it, and it's just like... Okay, these are still, like, glowing. I mean, I guess that's better. Well, anyway, I guess it's just gonna be weird lighting. Sorry. I guess that's what you come to this channel for at this point anyway. Something. Of course, I, a degenerate, you know, birth control, pill-popping feminist, hell-bent on destroying traditional family values, you know, was interested in what these novels have to say. I found it just really interesting. It's weird for me to keep them all the way back here. Maybe we'll just get this, like... Maybe if I put Dorian Gray on top. No. Well... This is a fucking disaster. I should just fucking cancel this whole video. No, I mean, of course I was interested in what these novels had to say because I've just like noticed that American novels in general tend to be a lot more conservative than say like British novels when it comes to like talking about sex. Like in America, it'll be like and just like a regular like romance like aimed at adults. There is this specific aversion to like talking about the body in like a sexual way. Whereas in like British like romance novels, like I'm thinking whoever did like the Flatshare and the Road Trip, I think it's Is it Beth O'Leary? The body does get talked about. And I've noticed this even in like Japanese literary fiction. Like it gets addressed more, whereas like America has this like specific aversion to it. So I was super interested when all of the, I mean, I don't know if these, like this recent trend is like attempting to like counter that a little bit. Like my spoiler alert for you is that it's failing miserably when it doesn't fail and when it actually does a good job, but like, you know, the American reader base just like fucking hates it. So I have read 3 novels like this in the past year or so, and then I have a tip for the hangman here is kind of a bonus. This is actually a historical fiction about Kit Marlowe, but the sex in this was so bad that, like, I felt like I had to include it in this conversation. But yeah, so I've read 3, like, sex literary fiction novels in the past year or so. 2 of these are debuts, one of them is not. And what I found is that most of them, despite clearly thinking themselves to be like progressive and feminist and like sex positive or whatever, a lot of them actually are quite sterile with messages that actually do still like veer towards pretty staunchly conservative approaches to not just sex, but also like representation. Like there's a really weird disconnect between what these books are trying to do politically and what like they're actually doing. Why conservative messages are being marketed by supposed liberals to liberal audiences, and why those liberal audiences are eating those messages up is really anybody's guess. Don't think about it, don't think about it, don't think about it, don't think about it, don't think about it. What I want to do today is just give a comparison of the 3 books that I read with an honorable mention of A Tip for the Hangman. I will review each book as well as giving my thoughts on like the way that it approaches to, sex. Spoiler alert, I liked one of them and it was the lowest rated one on Goodreads. I'm gonna touch on reception and then I will conclude with a larger diagnosis of what I think might be happening with this new like subgenre of literary fiction. So the first book that I read is Shmutz by Felicia Berliner. This is her debut novel. This has the absolutely irresistible premise of a Russian Orthodox Jewish woman getting addicted to pornography. And the story just follows her discovery of sex and orgasm through pornography. It raises this kind of interesting dilemma that a lot of feminists have over under what circumstances can something like pornography be excusable or like helpful to combating conservatism. Shmutz does a pretty good job of like addressing both sides of pornography, so I will give it that. The protagonist, Rizal, her family basically controls every aspect of her life, including the man that she will someday marry. They barely allow her to attend college. It's only after a lot of convincing that they eventually allow her to. So with all of her life so strictly controlled by her family, Rizal is like somewhat liberated by watching pornography. Porn facilitates an introduction to her own body and her own pleasure that she probably wouldn't have gotten anywhere else. Without it, she would have kind of remained in the dark about those areas of like self-actualization. However, as the text goes on, Rizal is kind of funneled into the darker areas of like her porn website's algorithm, more and more like extreme content. And she becomes quite disturbed and spooked, justifiably, when she finds a video featuring a very young girl who looks like her little sister. All of this is well and good, but this book kind of like stops its narrative about halfway through where I would expect it to stop its narrative. The protagonist just chooses to retreat from the freedom that she's been inching towards for most of the book into an arranged marriage with a man that she is trying and pretty much failing, at least in my opinion, to convince herself and the reader that she likes. The book ends with her sneaking a secret cell phone into the wrapping of a menstrual pad after she goes off into marriage with this guy. for reasons which are never really disclosed to the reader. Maybe presumably so she can keep watching porn and just have it as like this secret private pleasure for herself. Maybe to someday escape her husband. We don't know. This book was kind of frustrating to me because I was really hoping for something that like challenged my views about pornography a little bit more than this did. I know I said that I enjoyed that this kind of addressed both the liberatory and oppressive aspects of pornography, but I felt like it did that just in a very surface level way, like merely in the premise of the book. Like the narrative itself just didn't really deliver on that front, I don't feel like, because it eventually kind of, I felt, concluded with a pretty staunchly like conservative view of sex. I was interested in a narrative that discussed the dangers of sexual repression and put a woman in a complicated situation where something that would normally oppress people like her, like, liberated her as an individual. Like, I think that's a really interesting conundrum to play with, and I was presuming that that's what this book was going to do. It felt like all the pieces were in place for the author to do that, and then, like she just didn't for some reason. All satisfaction is like removed from the narrative when Rizal changes her mind and just like retreats and destroys all narrative progress that we've made so far by going back to just letting her whole life be controlled by her parents. Rizal's retreat really removes like the complexity about porn and sex from this narrative and instead kind of veers the overall like takeaway from the book into like a sometimes like sexual repression and like control and manipulation is like good and for the greater good and your own safety. Like, and that's like what the moral of this actual narrative as Berliner in practice wrote it seems to be. And I say moral because, like, it's pretty clear to me that this book is trying to push a certain political standpoint, and that's something that was present in most of the books that I'm going to talk about in this video. And, like, that political standpoint is basically that misogyny is, like, sometimes good and okay because some women like it. Maybe you could say that it's attempting to weigh the misogyny of pornography against the misogyny of being forced to marry and bear children for a man that you like don't even love with no education and finances of your own. But like, to me, they're not really comparable. Like, I think it's kind of stupid to act like those two things are equivalent, especially if, like in this book, we're just focusing on the individual and the impact that those things have on the individual. Rizal abandons her new progressive friends that she meets at college after she's nearly sexually assaulted on a beach trip that they take together. Prior to that, she'd been trying on more revealing clothes like blue jeans, and then she basically, through almost being sexually assaulted, learns her lesson. At least that's the way it's kind of like portrayed in the narrative, and then she goes back to like her traditional clothing. This incident, like the near sexual assault, was really, really weird to me. What's really weird about it though is that instead of what I would presume would be the logical next step, where it complicates her ideas of freedom, the incident catalyzes a complete reversal of like all personal development that she has undergone throughout the entire novel. It makes sense that like it would be something that she, like, it would be a hurdle that she has to encounter, because like I said, when you raise women to be deferential to men, kind of the side effect that's not really a side effect but more an intended consequence of that kind of like submissiveness being brought up in you is that it's easier for predatory men to take advantage of you. That's literally why feminists are against like women being raised to be submissive and docile towards men. But like, what I don't get about this is that Rizal like clearly has started to learn something about assertiveness with her new freedom, right? She does assert herself and tell him no, and she gets away unscathed. So that narrative, like, doesn't really work. Because if she gets away, then that kind of downplays the degree to which, like, patriarchal religions and, like, teaching women to be submissive, like, affects women and makes them vulnerable to predatory men. For me, that whole thing didn't really make a ton of sense. It even makes less sense because there's a later scene where Rizal is sexually assaulted just by a woman, which to me is just extremely unrealistic. I don't know what it is in, like, literary fiction that it's like every other literary fiction book you read, there is like a rapist lesbian in it. It kind of, like, feeds into this, like, really fucking annoying, like, women are the true predators, like, oh, but nobody talks about the woman rapists conversation that is just happening in a lot of progressive circles right now. And frankly, I no longer, like, think it's deep to show, like, women rapists in your fiction. Like, specifically if it's, like, in lieu of showing a male rapist, especially when it's happening at the rate that it's happening in fiction. We're literally living in fucking opposite world in the literary fiction sections of bookstores. By far the most enjoyable part of this book was watching Rizal, like, inching towards freedom. Like, I liked watching her secretly buying jeans and, like, chickening out the first day she plans to wear them and, like, finally working up the courage to wear them. Like, it was all very just, like, sweet and nice to watch. And because of that, I was just screaming, no, 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 as Rizal started to retreat back into herself and just let her parents start making all her decisions for her again. Also, it's very bizarre to me how this book is getting marketed, because on Goodreads, the page literally says that Rizal is on a quest to get married, when, like, throughout this entire book, Rizal is, like, unwilling to get married. Like, she's not enthusiastic about it. I think this author might literally not understand what book she actually wrote, which is pretty damn frustrating to me because, like, I like difficult topics. I like things that are, like, really, really hard to write about. And so to me, like, if you're gonna write about a difficult topic, like, that's the whole fun of it, is that you have to do it really well to get it right. Like, this is why I write about difficult shit, because I think it's fun to, like, try to meet that challenge and do it well. But it sounds like you literally didn't eat, like, were you on a fucking deadline or something? Like, how do you not know whether she's willing and excited to get married or not? Complying with somebody's demands when you're financially dependent on them is not, like, a free and informed choice. That's a coerced choice. That's not exactly the pinnacle of free will. If this book has a moral, it's basically that, like, if you were brought up submissive, that you should just, like, stay submissive. You're unprepared for the scary place that is the real world, and it's better to probably just do what your parents say. The real world is stinky and corrupted, and everything is ruined now because we live in a time when there's antibiotics and it's all really just terrible, blah, 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 blah. If this was written by some, like, shut-in evangelical homeschooler, I would understand. I would be like, what did I expect? But, like, this is coming out of, like, an MFA program. You guys are supposed to be artists, and this is what you're coming up with? This? You guys are supposed to be artists. And there's also this, like, really weird abortion scene about three-fourths of the way through the book, where, like, Rizal finds out that, like, her mom had an abortion at some point, and, like, I guess it's supposed to make the mom look more progressive or something. Like, oh, you thought she was a horrible sexist, you know, like, treating her daughter like she's property to be married off, but actually, she got an abortion, so she must be progressive and forward-thinking, and it's all fine. I can't believe that I'm saying this, but I kind of wanted Rizal's porn addiction to carry her to freedom. Like, it would have been uncomfortable for me to read, but I think that would have been, like, that would have been, like, a more interesting and cohesive message. That's it. That's it for that one. The Hop by Diana Clark was the next one that I read. This was by far the worst one off of this whole list. I was insulted by the plot. I was insulted by the vibe. Everything in this book was just a goddamn lie. Basically, this is about a woman who starts working in a brothel in Nevada because she liked running a kissing booth in middle school. Our protagonist is like a sociopath, was incapable of feeling arousal, and just likes the kissing booth lessons because she enjoys feeling power and control over the men who pay her money to give them. This book frequently insists, and like, I mean insists, like it preaches directly at you that it's actually like girl boss and Machiavellian mastermindery to sell access to like the most intimate and vulnerable part of you for money. Honestly, I think I really wouldn't have had a problem with this if it was just like an honest like portrayal of this individual person's life working at a brothel. Like, I think it would have been interesting. Like, I just thought it sounded intriguing, but this is very clearly written by like a delusional, insulated person who doesn't like know that much about like sex work and what it's actually like. Like, I remember reading there was like a global survey of like 10,000 women in sex work, and it was literally like 95% of the women like across the different countries surveyed said that the thing that they wanted most was a way out of that line of work. You're seriously gonna like directly preach to me in this book, like not even like the character thinks this, but like you're gonna directly preach to me that actually sex work is like a cool thing that makes you have power over men? If it makes you have power over men, then why don't more men do it? And also, why do so many, like literally the overwhelming majority of people in that line of work want nothing more than just to leave it? Like, why would that be if it really makes you so powerful? I just like really want to know how much Pornhub paid this author to like make the pimp of the brothel who gets the main character pregnant like this like dad bod hottie. The pimp is described as being hot in this. There is literally a passage in this where the like the main girl at the brothel like talks about her clients, and it's mainly like nervous 20-somethings who just want to cuddle, and like the main girl is just like so grateful that she gets to help all of these men by risking death and torture and disease and pregnancy. It's like time for the rumor that only artsy sad boy incels pay for sex to fucking die. There was literally not one gross sex buying man in this whole book. Not one dude with an STI, like not one dude who was there one dude who was mean? There might have been one dude who was like mean. I actually don't think so. Even like, cause like, even when I think the one guy was mean, it still like framed it like it wasn't that bad and like it was fine. Like, you're literally erasing the real struggles that sex workers have by like pretending that every dude who shows up to pay for sex is like clean and nice and has good intentions and sees you as a person. That's just not how it is. People are awful to sex workers. Like, that's why so many people want to leave that line of work. There are also these just unbearable passages where the characters will like preach fucking their dialogue together, but it's not even like real dialogue. It literally, like, I think she just wanted to write a political pamphlet or something, but she wrote a book instead. I've been seeing this shit so much in literary fiction lately. It's not even just in like these sex books. It's literally like, at least in Shmutz, like they felt like real characters, but in this, the characters are literally just like mouthpieces for the author's ill-informed fucking just like Twitter viewpoints. Like, it's not even like real personality or dialogue. And I really can't tell you what most of these characters' personalities are, because they just like don't have one really. Like, it's crazy that you wrote this book and you're like trying to be like post-feminist and like post-objectification, and like then you objectify every woman in the book. Also, I hate how the men are like never the villains in this book. It is like literally this book like has this idea that, and that there are these like evil feminist overlords that like are stinky and just want to like ruin their fun or whatever. And the author claims that she talked to like real sex workers for this book. I don't know if I'm convinced, because like it just does not reflect the reality of the average sex worker's life. And I think it might be time to talk about the fact that like many of the sex workers who are available to like interview about their lives and able to even talk about the shit that they've gone through are probably the lucky ones. Like, that's the creepy thing, is that like most of the people who are living this kind of life kind of like disappear. It's really fucking dark shit. And you're just offering this sanitized version. Literally, whenever the characters go on one of their rants, it's literally like, hey, Sandra. Hey, Jane. You know what I really hate, Sandra? What, Jane? I just can't stand those big, fat, meanie feminists who apparently run the government somehow and want to take away men's right to purchase me as a product. That just makes me really, really mad. Oh, sure, I really hate being considered a full human being. I'm sure that there's no particular reason why most sex workers are women. Probably it's just in women's nature to want to pleasure men, right? That sounds about right. Oh, what's that? You thought it was annoying how overt my political views were from that little skit? Great, now you know how I felt for this entire book. Also, this book is like kind of insanely racist and transphobic. I don't fucking know. I don't understand. First of all, the majority of porn stars are white, so it doesn't make sense that she tried to diversify this brothel so much. Because frankly, it is mostly like white sex workers who can even manage to get themselves in these kind of conditions. It's just crazy that she tried to literally put somebody of like every race and every fucking like identity into this brothel. And anyway, it's fucking transphobic because there's this trans woman who is at the brothel, who works there with them. She literally will be like, darling this, darling that, like says darling at the beginning of every sentence. And I'm just sitting here like, this is not normal. The Asian character who's like the main girl at the brothel, she like embraces this like cutesy, like fetishizing Asian fever, like aesthetic, but she like acts like it's like empowering somehow to do so, and she's like, yeah, I just have like such a good time pretending to be cute for these like men or whatever. And also the one black woman at the brothel is like the meanest character out of the bunch, and she's like the dominatrix who like dominates people or whatever. What you're gonna do is you're gonna fucking not only make the black woman the most like aggressive character in the brothel and the one who's like mean to the protagonist, who is white by the way. Like it was, I'm sorry, like to me, like I don't know if the author was trying to be subversive or whatever, but like to me it made me like a little bit uncomfortable. Like that kind of struck me as kind of odd. Also, like all of the women are in these like gay relationships with each other, but there's just like no chemistry. The well not only has run dry, it was never even there to begin with. There is just no well. The fucking main character will talk to like the Asian stereotype girl and be like, oh yeah, like you just, no one else gets us. Like nobody else understands us, but we understand each other. And I'm just sitting there like, what are you talking about? Like, it's literally like, it's just like, it's like shoving two Barbies' faces together. Like, it's just like, it's plastic. Like, none of them have personalities because they only exist to parrot the author's political views. This book was supposed to be a Twitter thread. Oh my fucking god. Also, the elderly woman in this, like, gets murdered, and it's just like, of course. The book basically ends without anybody, like, really investigating or, like, feeling sad about it. Even though the serial killer, like, killing prostitutes is, like, supposedly one of the book's major plot points, like, this is another way this book just sanitizes sex work. Because, like, even though he's supposedly one of the major plot points, his presence isn't even really felt throughout this whole book. And then when he kills one of the prostitutes, of course, it's, like, just the old one. No one cares about it. So I guess, I don't know, maybe I'm wrong. Maybe at least it's realistic in that way, because, you know, the old woman doesn't look as sexy or whatever anymore, is killed, and none of them really care, even though they, like, kind of pretend. But it, like, doesn't feel real because she barely gets any speaking roles throughout the entire book. I haven't mentioned the serial killer in the there are no bad men section of my complaining. Because he, like, literally isn't present for the entire book. Like, it's supposedly the whole plot point of the book, but he never appears. Like, in the Goodreads description, they act like that's what the main plot of this book is about. It's literally, like, this book literally feels like the writer, like, forgot to include the serial killer, and then just, like, had to add him in at the end. Main character in this also gets pregnant by the pimp. He's, like, an evil man for, like, trying to get her to abort or whatever, but she's, like, a good woman, I guess, and, like, wants to be a mom, even though she has, like, no way of fucking, like, providing for this child. Because the guy is literally trying to, like, control her and be like, you know, I'm not gonna let you work here if you have this kid. So she has literally no means of, like, providing for this child, and she's famous at that point, so she's not gonna be able to get another job because they all recognize her as this, like, sex worker. And, like she has no home, like, she's basically gonna, and so she's not only not gonna have a job, but she's also gonna be, like, without a roof over her head and homeless. But she's just, like, she wants to be a mom that bad, and she's, like, just gonna have the kid, and I guess she's just hoping everything will work out. And I guess it's fine, because all the women, like, storm out of the brothel together, and they're like, we're filming it for social media. Someone on social media will see it and save us. This is gonna age like milk, by the way. This is literally, like, one of the most sexist and ignorant and sheltered books that I've ever read in my life. Like, it is so ignorant of material reality. And I think that's what offends me about it, is, like, I don't... Like, if a book is ignorant, but it's, like, not trying to be political, it's just, like, I can give it a lot more space. But when you come out of the gate and your whole book is just about preaching your politics to people, and then you look uninformed as shit, and, like, you don't know what you're doing, and, like, the whole thing just reads like a brain rot Twitter thread. I don't even have Twitter. I just, like, know at this point what to look for. Like, that's bad writing. Like, I don't think you want to write a book. I think you want to post on Twitter. And I think other people don't want to read books. They just want to read on Twitter because this is getting crazy high ratings. Do you not realize you're writing a narrative? Like, how do you not realize that you're writing a narrative? You know that's the point of literary fiction, right? It's so privileged in its ignorance too. Like, it's so self-satisfied while also having no idea what it's talking about. I want to say that I can't believe a real woman wrote this, but at this point I can, given the level of just, like woman-hating that I am picking up on in so much literary fiction that I read. The MFA workshops are just churning out this brain rot like they're getting paid to do it, and I guess they are getting paid. Also, this one, actually, I shouldn't say it came out of a literary workshop, because this actually isn't even a debut novel. Do you want to know what the author's debut novel was about? Guess. It's an anorexia book. I think with, like Shmutz and The Hop, I think people with these, like, they're just rating them highly because they kind of agree with, like the overall conservative ideas about, you know, women are either, in Shmutz, it's women are private property, in The Hop, it's women are public property, and either way, you're, like, supposed to enjoy, like, not being a full human being. We are doing four-dimensional chess, and somehow I'm making my own oppression, and subhuman status in society, like, work for me. Like, I feel like people are rating these highly because they are seeing their own ignorance reflected back to them in a mirror, and they're applauding it, basically. It's a perfect reflection of how people in America think about sex, which is that they don't. Like, people in America are scared to think about sex, which is why books like this, which literally just reflect traditional values about women back to people, are so successful. Because you don't have to think to internalize these books. You guys know you can ask for more, right? Speaking of more, Acts of Service is crazy because it is the lowest rated out of all of these books that I've read. And it's like, it's by far the best. Like, this, I think, might be an example of an actually more challenging book about sex. And it just got, it got flamed so bad on Goodreads. And I was gonna make an actually it's good episode about it, but I think I'll just talk about it now. By far my favorite out of these books. It is also a debut, and I'm probably going to be rereading it at some point and looking out for future stuff by this author. I know the cover is super cringe. It's not just the best of a bad bunch. Like, it's genuinely, like, it really stands out as the first time that I've ever seen sexuality explored this just successfully. I'd honestly, like, really highly recommend this if you're looking for a book that, like explores sex and desire as a topic. So this book follows Eve, a bisexual woman who impulsively uploads nude photos of herself to this, like, nude photo sharing website without the knowledge of her girlfriend. And she basically starts this secret affair with this elusive couple made up of this guy, Nathan, and this woman, Olivia. They're just this attractive, elusive couple. I think the way that I would describe this book is like Secret History, but if Donna Tartt included all the sex scenes. Yeah, it's basically like that. You know, there's a scandal at the end involving Nathan doing some pretty bad shit. The book doesn't actually have a ton of plot. It's very, very character focused, which I like. It basically just follows Eve's interactions with this couple, and it follows her affair with them, like dynamics that emerge between them. And I really liked getting to kind of peep behind the curtain a little bit and look at the dynamics that affect all three of the parties involved. Nathan, ladies, if he's not a little bit problematic, I'm not really interested. He's got kind of just the right amount of edge to him. I feel like he is a little bit problematic in the ways that he talks about women, but because it is realistic, sexism affects us even in, like, our most intimate moments with men, at least for straight women, straight and bisexual women, I should say. I don't know, the prose was just fucking beautiful. I thought Nathan was so dreamy, though. I mean, this is, like, the first time when I've, like, actually found, like, a male character in a book. At least the first time in, like, adulthood when I've actually found, like, a male character in a book kind of dreamy. I found all of them pretty compelling characters, and Nathan was absolutely sexy. Like, Eve's character is that she basically is, like, too passive. Like, she is kind of this, like, desperate to please men passive character. And I know people have been criticizing this in the reviews, but I felt like it was self-aware. Like, I felt like the author was putting that on display for us rather than endorsing it. Listen to this passage. "Thank you," Nathan said each time he handed the cocktail menu back to the server, and there was no trace of apology in his voice. He was not trespassing. Nowhere he went did he trespass, and it had never occurred to anyone to question him. "Thank you," I said to his doorman on the way out of the building late in the evenings, but each time it was an apology. "And you like to feel superior to her, don't you?" Nathan said. "Don't you feel safe somehow because you're more beautiful than her?" Eve smiled again because it felt good to reveal the truth to someone who liked her for it. Like, it's just so, it's so deliciously problematic. It's so deliciously exploratory. Just about those kinds of thoughts. Like, and I think this is what I found intriguing about Nathan, is that I feel like most men in real life are just petrified of offending women. And Nathan just will overtly say exactly what he's observing. There are some really controversial things that are explored in this book, so I think that might be kind of why people are upset. I mean, I guess it's 2023 and it's still a lot for a woman to write about, not just about, like, sex and desire, but about, like, controversial things within the topic of sex and desire. So yeah, if you're one of those people who kind of gets their panties up in a twist about, like, stuff in books not being, like, therapist approved or being toxic, like, this isn't for you. I, for one, love toxicity in literature. Like, if it's not toxic, I'm not interested. I think we need to bring back toxicity in books, especially in romance, okay? If someone isn't a little bit possessive, if someone doesn't cross some kind of a line, I'm not interested. Like, when everything is therapist approved, you get those fucking, like, sterile romance novels where the fucking covers look like they were made in Canva. Like, no, I want part two interrogation. Sorry. It has a really complex and mature examination of eroticism and romance and sex. Yeah, if you want a book that is about sex and kind of maturely examines sex, it's not just smut, but also isn't anti-woman propaganda, I would recommend Acts of Service, despite its extremely unfortunate cover. I'm not gonna talk too much about A Tip for the Hangman. This is a really cringy historical fiction about Kit Marlowe, the playwright. He was from Elizabethan England. He lived around the same time as Shakespeare and probably met him at some point. And I just had to fucking mention this. The reason it's in the introduction is because literally, this is what first drew my attention. This is what really made me start to realize that there's a problem with sex scenes in literature right now. Like, that there is, like, a really serious problem with it. It's basically, don't read this, it's basically published fan fiction about Kit Marlowe and Tom Watson, and it has, the sex scenes, I just find it very peculiar because the sex scenes are kind of written as if by somebody who has never had sex before. It literally reads like it was written by, like, a 14-year-old trying to imagine what sex is like. And it doesn't work for the Marlowe character because Kit Marlowe himself is, like, he was a spy for the government. Like, he was a spy for the government. He got into fucking street fights. Like, he died at 29 because someone fucking stabbed him in the eye. Like, he was into serious shit. Like, the idea of Marlowe describing orgasm as swallowing the stars when he's in college? No offense, I think you just, like, don't get Marlowe. Because he would not fucking say that.
You had to see that.
Like, it literally was like they have ascended to the astral plane and their souls are mingling or something. Like, that's what I mean when I say super conservative about sex, because there's this like disgust for the body. There's this new trend in literary fiction which is conservative but is trying to pass itself off as liberal. I'm sure a lot of these authors think that they're progressive, but just because you say you're something doesn't mean you automatically are. If you're a progressive author, then I'm an appreciated author, and we all know that that isn't true. There are a lot of trendy books about sex that are getting published, but few of them are really exploring sex and desire as a topic in a way that I find captivating. Instead, they reiterate that women should be submissive, that we should embrace that our bodies are seen as public property and as commodities that are available for purchase, either through a contract like marriage or literal exchange of capital. I think the reason that I liked Acts of Service the best out of these novels, and why it stands out and potentially why it's gotten so much backlash, is because the main character does act on her desire pretty unapologetically. Fiction, at least American fiction, has this really weird aversion to sex still, and that sets it apart from literary fiction in other countries, I feel like. Especially when it concerns women's autonomy and women's pleasure. And honestly, I can't say much more other than that it disturbs me. That's it for this video. I hope you've learned something. I hope you enjoyed. Let me know if there are other books that you've noticed this kind of thing in. I will see you in the next video. Bye.